Our image of childhood is one of relatively carefree growth. But that perception is being challenged as more and more children in the United States receive psychiatric diagnoses and psychotropic medications. This trend has given rise to controversies about why and how children are diagnosed and treated for emotional and behavioral disturbances. The Hastings Center, an independent bioethics research institution with a grant from the National Institute of Mental Health, brought together clinicians and researchers, scholars and advocates to understand the agreements and disagreements about how ADHD, depression, and bipolar disorder are diagnosed and treated. This Hastings Center special report was written by research scholars Erik Parens and Josephine Johnston. It also includes sidebar perspectives from 10 of the project participants.
It seemed like the debate about children and psychiatry was rather polarized. It seemed to pit, it still does seem to pit people who think that children are being over-medicalized, even victimized by an intolerant culture on the one hand, and people on the other who think that, or suggest sometimes that this is a purely scientific matter, has nothing to do with values, and the trends that we're observing are a function solely of scientific progress. Now, neither Josie nor I believes either of those stories. There's a lot of insight on both sides, surely, but we wanted to investigate further to try to get a more nuanced take on what's really going on. And it is much more complicated than either of those two simple stories would have us believe.
Neither Erik nor I are physicians or scientists. So to talk about pediatric psychiatry and the decisions that are made diagnosing and treating children and understanding those decisions, we needed the help of a big group of people. So we convened a series of 5 workshops where we brought together a huge range of people with expertise relevant to the questions we were addressing, and we had people with really diverse perspectives and who disagreed with each other, especially at the beginning when they didn't know each other very well and they weren't familiar with each other's work. There were a lot of misunderstandings or disagreements, and what we asked people to do was to talk and engage and debate and discuss over these 5 workshops the various different aspects of these controversies about diagnosing and treating children.
A lot of us, I think, sometimes would like to imagine that we can look to nature to know where the line is between people who are disordered enough to warrant treatment and people who are not. And alas, that isn't the case. It turns out that it is up to human beings like us to make value judgments that are infused with values to determine whether or not to intervene. And that's a huge ethical responsibility. And I think sometimes we wish we didn't have it, that we could instead appeal just to nature, just look to nature, a lab value. That's certainly the dream. And maybe someday we'll have that, but we certainly don't today. And I guess to a large extent, it's because we don't have those lab values that human values are so important to recognize.
So we can all think of somebody we've met who we think is sort of borderline ADHD or borderline depression, has borderline depression. And, you know, some of us, because of where we work or our families, we can think of people who clearly have depression or who clearly have ADHD. And there's always going to be that range. So the question is, how do you deal with that range? And how do you be explicit about the decisions that are made in the gray zone?
In what we call the zone of ambiguity, right?
Right, sorry, that's right, in the zone of ambiguity.
I think that one of the core areas of agreement regarded the fact that there are children who are terribly impaired as a result of their emotional and behavioral disturbances. So even people who are quite enthusiastic about pharmacological treatment and people who are quite critical can acknowledge, can agree that there are children who desperately need help, and they can agree that there are some children who are receiving various forms of treatment who probably do not need it.
There was a lot of discussion about the way things should be done and the options that should be put to parents and children. And then there was a lot of discussion about what it's really like to actually practice medicine and to actually try to get help for troubled children. The child psychiatrists we met are all struggling to provide help for children in systems that make it hard to do the right thing. And they are using tools, medications and therapies that work really well for some and really don't work that well for others and often have side effects, and they are trying and struggling to balance that.
I think that not only is there agreement about the need for these different modalities, I think there's also agreement that too many of the social forces at work today bearing down on all of us are pushing the pharmacological intervention, even though the experts agree that a multimodal approach is optimal. This project is part of an ongoing interest of some of us here at the Hastings Center in the use of technologies to shape ourselves and our children. People actually in the West have been thinking about the meaning of shaping ourselves with technologies probably at least since Homer, when Homer was thinking about lotus eaters eating funny drugs that gave them all sorts of strange capacities. So this is not a new question, and I suspect it's not the last time that we in the Hastings Center will be dealing with questions like this.